Good morning, members of council and staff. Today, as we do our moment of personal reflection, I'm just going to ask that you keep in your thoughts RCMP Constable Havinder Dahami of the Strathcona Detachment located east of Edmonton, who passed away in the line of duty. Also, I just want to advise members of council, if you haven't heard, Councillor Joanne Dye's husband Gary had passed away, and there's a celebration of life tomorrow. And finally, I want to recognize in the city of Oshawa, former Councillor Gail Bates, who was a part of Oshawa during my time as mayor, passed away, and the funeral is tomorrow. Members of council, if you'd like to join me in a moment of reflection. Thank you. We are currently located on land which has long served as a site of meeting and exchange among the Mississauga peoples and is the traditional and treaty territory of the Mississaugas of Scugog Island First Nation. We honor, recognize, and respect this nation and the Indigenous people as traditional stewards of the lands and waters on which we meet today. Mr. Clerk, can you do a roll call and explain the rules, please?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. No particular notes on the rules today. This will be an electronic roll call beginning now.
We're good. Members of council will do declarations of pecuniary interest. Mr. Clerk, I see none. Members of council, just a couple items before we start the meeting. I'd like to take a minute to remind everyone that May 7th to 13th is Emergency Preparedness Week, or EP Week. It is recognized nationally as well here in Durham Region. I'd like to thank all the first responders and staff in the region who work tremendously hard 24 hours a day, 7 days a week to keep us safe. EP Week is a great time to make sure that your kits, plans, and emergency items are up to date and ready to go. The region will be sharing lots of important information during EP Week and throughout the year, including details on our new Flood Ready Durham website and on our annual Nuclear Emergency Preparedness Survey, which is open now. The best place to follow along with all this is on social media and on durham.ca. Today you will receive the completely redesigned At Ready Guide. It is a fun and easy way for families to spend time together and to become more prepared for the potential emergencies in the region. Have a read through it and help us empower our residents to be at the ready. Your support in being emergency preparedness champions for Durham Region is much appreciated. And I have the opportunity to recognize a member of our team, but I wish to inform members of council at the same time that Dr. Patricia Abbey, a director of oral health, is retiring on April 31st, 2023. Since joining the region in 2001, Dr. Abbey has had a distinguished dental oral health career. Locally, she has helped lead and guide the oral health division through significant change. She has assisted in the implementation of mandatory oral health programs, including school oral health screening, dental treatment for children and seniors through Healthy Smiles Ontario, it's referred to as HSO, and the Ontario Seniors Dental Care Program, OSDCP, as well as supporting Ontario Works and Ontario Disabilities Program, ODSP Dental Benefits Program. These programs have helped vulnerable children and from low-income families, adults and seniors to access necessary dental care that they would not otherwise have received. Provincially, Dr. Abbey helped create the Oral Health Information Support System, a software solution to capture oral health information for children and youth, which now extends to seniors. She's also supported the development of the Dental Services Protocol for 2008 Ontario Public Health Standards, as well as the Amalgamation Healthy Smiles Program. These programs play a significant part in reducing the burden of oral disease and improving overall health and well-being. Dr. Abbey has been a prolific teacher. In addition to coaching and mentoring her team, she has taught dental hygiene and assisted students at Durham College dentistry students at the University of Toronto throughout her career. Dr. Abbey has always been a very strong and passionate advocate for equitable access to oral health. She is engaged in her local dental society and community partners to improve access for those who are unable to afford care. She has also advocated for improvements to dental care and treatment for the needy at numerous local and provincial tables. To cap off her career after the new Ontario Seniors Dental Care Program was announced, Dr. Abbey was instrumental in securing funding to build and equip a new 7-operatory dental clinic in downtown Oshawa to serve the needs of low-income seniors and adults. In recognition of her lifetime achievements, Dr. Abbey was awarded the ALPHA Distinguished Service Award in 2022. Please join me in thanking Dr. Abbey for her individual contributions to improve the oral health and well-being of Durham's neediest residents and wishing her good health and happiness throughout her impending retirement. Members of Council, if you would please join me and stand. And Dr. Abbey, I know that your husband's retiring at the same time, and I wish you whatever your life journey is going forward and that all your dreams come true and from the residents of the region of Durham. From us to you, thank you for making a difference in the lives of our residents, and well done. On another note, I would like to welcome and congratulate Dr. Miriam Pazinski, who was the successful candidate for the position of Director of Oral Health Division. Dr. Pazinski was the successful candidate of our recent Director of Oral Health competition and is a respected and dedicated dentist with 25 years of general dental, hospital, and public health practice experience. She came to Durham Region as a clinical dentist in 2015 and has been the clinical programmer since 2017 and was instrumental in leading the divisional pandemic response, implementing our new seniors dental care program, and helping facilitate Oral Health Division's recent move to 200 John Street in Oshawa. Please join me in congratulating Dr. Pazinski and welcome her to her new post, which begins today. Congratulations. Okay, Mr. Clerk, I think we'll move on to adoption of the minutes. Could I get a member of council to move item 4.1, which is the council meeting of March 29th, 4.2, which is the council meeting of April 12th, and the committee of the whole meeting of April 12th. Moved by Councillor Chapman, seconded by Councillor Crawford. On the three items, I'll call the vote. All those in favor? In opposition? Seeing none, that carries. We have a presentation this morning. Mr. Clerk, is Ms. Reddy chair? She's here. So I'd like to introduce a former member of a DRPS, and in her retirement, she's taken on the role as chair of the Durham Region Hospice in Whitby. And I'd like to welcome Eva to the podium today. I just pull your microphone down closer to you, and it'll come on automatically, and she's going to talk about the hospice project in Whitby.
Good morning, Chair Henry and members of Regional Council. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to give you an update on the status of our hospice residence build in Whitby. You may remember that we launched our fundraising campaign in 2018, and by the time we went to tender in November 2021, we had raised most of the necessary funds to build the Whitby Hospice Residence, approximately $7 million. Unfortunately, due to the impact on the construction industry of the pandemic, The cost of the project came in approximately $3.5 million more than originally estimated. Our board decided to postpone construction and to continue fundraising. Last year, we also visited some of the newer hospices to find out if there were any design changes we could make that would result in cost savings and better efficiencies. During these visits, we also learned from hospice staff that having outdoor patios during the pandemic was critical to keeping families close in some way when distancing restrictions were in place. We heard that many people who wanted to go and probably needed to go to a hospice residence during the pandemic lockdowns did not go because their family could not be with them. So despite our utter disappointment at not being able to proceed with construction in early 2022, we have been able to take advantage of the delay to make our beautiful hospice even better. We met with our architects in December to make a number of cost-saving changes and to add private patios outside each room. This will allow the resident and their bed to be easily moved outside by family members any time of the day or night to enjoy the sun and fresh air. And no families need to be completely separated if we have to deal with another pandemic. We are meeting with our architects tomorrow afternoon to discuss a few minor revisions, and then they can complete the final design. If all goes well, we believe that construction will begin before the end of the year. Since the spring of 2022, the Whitby project has raised approximately $850,000 for a total of $8.5 million in the bank or committed. We will spend the next couple of years on completing the fundraising to pay for construction costs and for furniture, fixtures, and equipment. We hope that the next tender result will not be as shocking as the first one. And most of you probably already know about our other wonderful news. On March 22nd, we hosted an event where I was honored on behalf of our board to announce the name of our hospice residence as Hospice Whitby Roger Anderson House. A group of generous developers contributed to meet the $2 million requirement for naming in honor of our former regional chair. When our final design is completed, I would like to come back to give you a tour of it. Unless someone has actually been to a hospice residence, it is difficult to understand exactly what it is, how you feel when you are there. But if you can see the floor plan, you will start to get a sense of what it will look like and that it is created as a home away from home for every resident of Durham Region who is facing end of life and their families to live well together until the end. And I would like to thank you all for supporting us with the annual proclamations for Durham Region Hospice Awareness Day on January 29th and for raising the flags here at regional headquarters. This support from all of our councils is assisting with our ongoing education throughout Durham Region about what a hospice residence is and why it is so necessary for our community to have it. Thank you.
So thank you. Questions, members of council? Seeing none, Mr. Clerk, online. Oh, sorry. Okay, request to speak, please. Okay, Councillor Shahid.
Thank you so much, Chair Henry. Through you, Eva, thank you so much for coming out today. You're doing tremendous work. My question today is, when are we looking to dig ground in Whitby?
We're hoping by November. The architects aren't fans of building foundations through the winter, so we just need to do some minor revisions. We will go back out to tender once we get approval, and we're ready to go by the fall.
Thank you. Furthermore, through you, Chair Henry, I had a beautiful visit at your facility down east, and I just was wondering if there was any feedback with what you have learned from that facility. It was beautiful, and the fact that the patios are used so often and so wonderfully, what would you be applying any feedback that is gained, if any, to Whitby?
Yeah, through our tours, things that were important 4 or 5 years ago and during the original planning phase aren't important anymore. So, for example, we don't need ceiling lifts in every room because the way that the beds are made, you don't need two staff to turn the residents in the bed anymore. The beds do all the work, so we've been able to cut out a lot of that structural costs from our build.
That's fantastic. One last question through you, Chair Henry. Is there a percentage that you have calculated versus what you had built before and now what is the percentage hike that you'll be spending for the Whitby one?
Well, the cost came in at $10.4 million with the original tender. We can live with that number, so we have a number to work towards. If it goes higher than that, we'll move ahead, but we really don't want to have a mortgage when we open the doors.
I totally understand, and thank you so much for the wonderful efforts that you've been doing. Thank you. Really appreciate it. That'll be all, Chair Henry.
Thank you. Councillor Wu.
Yeah, and through the chair, and thank you very much, Eva, for coming forward and giving us an update on the Whitby Hospice, the Roger Anderson House. Now, the developers were able to raise the $2 million to be able to get the naming rights. How much do you still have to raise? And that probably includes the, as you had mentioned, furniture, fixture, and equipment, and to get us to, be able to, was that 2 years of operating? So what are you hoping to still raise? And like you say, hopefully have no mortgage, and how they could go about donating?
Well, we're hoping to stick to $2.5 million over the next 2 years. And you can donate at
there's a group forward and hopefully putting the shovel in the ground this year. As you may know, they've gone out to tender and should hear sometime in May when they open up the tenders and see. Now, is there a plan for yourself? And I think my fellow councillor here mentioned, are you close to being able to go to tender?
I think we are. The architects, we just have to do some revisions, and then they'll send it out for the costing. The nice thing is Integrated Engineering, which did the costing for us originally, has all of the original plans. We haven't made a lot of major changes, so they'll be able to get their work done quickly, and then we can go out to tender once we get approval from the ministry.
Well, and my last comment would be, it'd be great once we have those hospices up and running in Durham region, to support those that are end of life. And we have Port Perry, Oak Ridges, Whitby, the Roger Anderson House, and Durham Region Hospice, Clarington. So congratulations to you and your group. Thank you.
Thank you on behalf of us as well and your entire team.
Thank
and
you.
We look forward to being there the day you break ground.
Okay. Thank you.
Members of Council, I just, in the beginning, I should have recognized that we will have a hard stop at 12 o'clock for an announcement related to Durham Region Transit in the lobby, and I hope that all of you will join us for that announcement. Next, it is our Troy Cheeseborough, our Chief of Region of Durham Paramedic Services, and Dr. Robert Kyle, Commissioner of Medical Officer of Health, on our long service awards. When you're ready, Chief.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and good morning, Mr. Chair and members of Council. So I'm very honored to be here this morning, and I just wanted to provide everybody with a little bit of a brief background before we get started with the actual presentation. So long service medals are something that have been in the military tradition for many, many years. They're awarded at increments of 12 years and then every 10 years following that. So 12, 22, 32, et cetera. It's something many of the emergency services adopted some time ago. With the exception of police, they do it a little bit differently. But the rest of the emergency services traditionally follow the military rules behind this. So this is something I lobbied for when I took on the role of chief, because as our Durham Paramedic Service, we were one of the last in the province to go ahead and initiate this program. So I did a little bit of work on it, did a presentation to the CAO and chair, which they endorsed, and I'm very happy to be here in front of you today to present some of these awards. So the awards we're going to be presenting today are just for a few of my staff that are kind of hitting some really extreme or superior thresholds, and I'll kind of identify those as we get up there. But I'm very honored to be here and have Dr. Kyle's assistance in presenting these to everyone. And one of our candidates you're going to be seeing is going to be receiving his medal today. And he actually started before the region even existed. So I will I'll identify that for you in this particular individual as well. So that's quite an honor to be still functioning as a paramedic in today's world. So I'm very happy to be here to be able to have that opportunity to present. So I'm going to utilize Dr. Kyle to initiate our first medal presentation, and I'll kind of take it from there.
I would like to recognize and honor Joe Shape for 32 years of service. Next, I would like to recognize Jeff Wright for 32 years. Glenn Campbell for 32 years. Michael Kelly for 32 years. Norm McKinnon for 32 years. Moving up to Derek Cocker for 42 years. Commander David Mokadan for 42 years. Last in this distinguished group, and certainly not least, with actually he has, I recently heard, he surpassed 56 years of service in this profession. He's getting recognized for 52 years on his award, Mr. Michael Neville. Passionate and supportive of this. You guys have been great advocates for the paramedics. service, and I thank you for your support over the years. And I know these folks are honored to represent this municipality and these councilors in their work that they continue to perform in the field after a fairly lengthy amount of service time. We all started when we were 10, by the way. That kind of explains why we're still working. So thank you very much. And Mr. Chair, we want to thank you. I'll let her line us up because she's the photo op.
Just wait a minute. We have somebody coming in from staff to take a photo.
Sure.
Members of council, for the audience, 9 regional employees with over 250 years service. That is something I'm sure it's a record in Ontario. But to you, all of you, I want to say thank you on behalf of the members of council. I want to thank your families because in order to be successful in your careers, especially in the world that you work in, if you didn't have the support at home, it would be a challenge. I want to thank you for the birthdays you missed, the anniversaries you missed, working through Christmas and New Year's. Our residents don't really understand the depth of what our frontline service people do. And on behalf of members of council and for all that you've given us, a round of applause is not nearly enough. But members of council, if you would please join me and stand and thank these gentlemen.
There'll be no dancing, there'll be no singing.
Thank you, Chief. So I would like to say you can stay if you would like to, but if you feel free to exit the meeting now, please do that. Okay, members of council, we'll move on. We're on to item 6.1. We have a delegation, Vanessa Falcon, Executive Director of Horizon House, and Sandra McCormick, Executive Director of the Denise House, on behalf of the Violence Prevention Coordinating Council of Durham Region. It's referred to as VPCC, recognizing intimate partner violence as an epidemic as per the jury recommendations of the Renfrew County Inquest dated June 28th, 2022. Good morning and welcome, and you have 5 minutes.
Good morning. Good morning, Chair Henry and members of Regional Council. My name is Vanessa Falcon, and I'm representing the Violence Prevention Coordinating Council of Durham, and I thank you for having me here along with our delegation this morning. The VPCC of Durham is a Ministry of Children, Community, and Social Service funded network of 35 community agencies and organizations committed to providing education, awareness, protection, and support to all women and girls so they can live safely in their own homes and communities. Through the power of collaboration, the VPCC works to prevent and end violence against women and girls in all its forms. I would like to begin by explaining why we are here. On the morning of September 22, 2015, in rural Renfrew County, Natalie Warmerdon, Anastasia Cusack, and Carol Culleton were murdered by a man with whom they each had a past relationship. The perpetrator was arrested later that day and has been imprisoned ever since. In 2019, the coroner's office announced the province would hold an inquest into the murders. The inquest, called the CKW inquest, took place in June 2022 in Renfrew County. After listening to 3 weeks of testimony and reviewing voluminous written exhibits, the five-person jury returned with a verdict that included 86 recommendations. This morning, the VPCC of Durham is asking you, Chair Henry, and Council, to pass a motion to declare intimate partner violence an epidemic, which is recommendation number one, and to include intimate partner violence in the Region of Durham Community Safety and Wellbeing Plan, which is recommendation number 10. Intimate partner violence refers to behaviors by an intimate partner or ex-partner that causes physical, sexual, or psychological harm, including physical aggression, sexual coercion, psychological abuse, and controlling behaviors. I notice my slides aren't keeping up with me, sorry. For the purpose of this presentation and the motion before you, I would like to provide you with some facts. Every 6 days, a woman is killed in Canada by her intimate or ex-partner. One in five women experience some form of abuse in their intimate relationship. This past year alone, 52 women in Ontario, or one every week, were victims of femicide. Since December of 2022 in Renfrew County, two women have been murdered. So what does this mean for Durham Region? Because of time constraints and for the purpose of this presentation, this slide refers to only data from the four violence against women shelters in Durham. There are many other organizations and agencies throughout Durham that provide services to those who are experiencing intimate partner violence. Throughout COVID-19, violence against women was often referred to as the pandemic within the pandemic. Intimate partner violence intensified because of lockdowns and stay-at-home orders that forced women to shelter in place with their abusers, creating a dangerous situation with no way to connect to needed supports and services. The result of all of this is an inaccurate picture of the actual impact of intimate partner violence in the Region of Durham. Shelters face the unique challenge of keeping women, children, and their staff safe. Pandemic practices and protocols that included mask wearing, social distancing, contributed to the challenges in maintaining services, programs, and influenced how those services were provided and accessed. You'll note that the shelter statistics seem lower during the COVID period of constraints and lockdowns, but are now steadily increasing to surpass pre-COVID data. The next slide looks at the numbers from Victim Services of Durham and some more recent statistics from Luke's Place. To highlight, in fiscal 2021-2022, Victim Services supported 4,438 victims of intimate partner violence, and Luke's Place served 873 women. From November 2022 to March 2023, there have already been three femicides in Durham Region. An 8-year-old little girl was killed by her father, Taylin Cook and Katie Keynes. And many of us remember all too well, 5 years ago, on March 15th, 2018, the triple homicide of Krasimira Pejanovsky and her children Roy, who was 15, and Vanna, who was 13. Residents of Ajax, they were all victims of intimate partner violence. And so the Violence Prevention Coordinating Council of Durham asks you, Chair Henry, and Council, to declare intimate partner violence an epidemic in accordance with recommendation number one of the 86 recommendations of the Renfrew County Inquest. We also ask that the Region of Durham integrate intimate partner violence into the Region of Durham Community Safety and Wellbeing Plan in accordance with recommendation number 10 of the 86 recommendations. I'd like to thank you, Chair Henry, and members of council for taking the time to listen to our delegation today.
Thank you. We have some questions. We'll start first with Mayor Foster to the delegation.
Mr. Chair, thank you. Thank you for coming forward. My information is probably a little bit dated, but my understanding is that femicides, at least a year ago, is a significant increase. But there had been a trend in that direction. So the pandemic was problematic, but we can't blame the pandemic. Is that fair?
I would say we can't blame the pandemic. You are correct. Femicides have been increasing for several years, even prior to the pandemic.
And IPV, the same thing. We would think we are progressing as a society, but the growth in incidence, the requirements of the shelters have consistently been increasing over the last number of years.
Yes, absolutely.
Now, I remember a time in Clarington, it's Bethesda House. Mm-hmm. While it's a number of years now, it's not that far in the past that they were not getting enough provincial funding to make them sustainable.
Mm-hmm. So I could, all four shelters in Durham Region receive funding from the provincial government. I can tell you that all of us need to fundraise a significant amount each year to continue our operations. We need volunteers. We're fundraising hundreds of thousands of dollars a year to just operate.
So we should be advocating with the province as we're meeting with the MPPs to recognize this issue. One of a lot of the recommendations the province has to do a lot relate to law enforcement. There is a safe shelter and disseminating information. Have you considered going to the local municipalities? So we've got libraries, we've got rec centers, the ability to create safe spaces, the ability to make sure that information is available.
Do you mean like presenting to those?
Present or even for the mover and seconder of the motion that's in front of us, it may be worthwhile to see how the local municipalities can be directly engaged.
So far we've presented to the municipality through the town of Ajax and town of Whitby, and we will continue to seek to present to each of the municipalities within
Perfect.
Durham. So we welcome the opportunity.
So we'll hear more from
yes.
you. Thank you ever so much. I don't get it. My line every time we talk to Bethesda House is I really want to shut them down simply because they're not needed. So that's my wish for all of you, that
yes.
That someday you wake up and your services aren't needed. Thank you.
Thank
Mr.
you.
Chair, thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Shahid, you were on the request to speak list, then you disappeared.
Oh,
and
I'm sorry.
So your mic's on. Go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you so much through you, Chair Henry. Such a pleasure to listen to you again. And I know that we passed a motion as well in Whitby on Monday. Mm-hmm. Myself and Councillor Bosnowski worked together to create mm-hmm. something that would help you take this further. My couple of questions are that one thing that was discussed at Town Whitby's motion was $150 per day for the hotel if somebody needs that in the hotel. Hotels right now within our community are so needed in case of emergency and so on, and the need of the fact that no hotel is $150 anymore. So we in the motion had added to the fact that we talk about that funding as well. Is that it? Can you shed some light on that, please?
So my particular agency that I represent doesn't get funding for hotels. I mean, we could use them in emergencies. I know that our partners, Victim Services, who are members of the VPCC, need that program regularly and need it to be properly funded, as I know they have to do significant fundraising as well. I don't have numbers on how much funding is provided for that. To us at the shelters, none is provided for specifically for hotel, but through our fundraising and flexibility, we can use it. But I don't know offhand the numbers that the province is funding for that specific program.
I
think, I don't have that information, but I know Victim Services uses that program, and it's a much needed program, absolutely.
And that's what they had addressed it there,
yeah.
that Victim Services need more
yes.
to bring these people somewhere, and hotels are needed all over
yeah.
our community. Through you, Chair Henry, just a couple of more questions. In terms of data during COVID, and I know that they were forced to live with the violent partners, is there any data of increase during COVID and lockdowns?
There is some data being collected, like there are studies being done. So we know that abuse didn't just stop because the pandemic. The shelters remained open throughout the pandemic, through every lockdown. No services were shut down or closed. However, we saw a decline in people's ability to access our services. So when our community members aren't able to go out to community centers, schools, and talk to other people, they're not getting the referrals. When you're in a home where you're sharing Wi-Fi and telephones, there's no privacy. People were not able to call for support. So it's very hard to have that data because those people would have to come forward now and tell us about it so we could track it. But there isn't anyone in our sector who would believe that just because our shelters weren't at capacity during the lockdowns, that there wasn't a need for them. There absolutely was the need, just people didn't know or couldn't get the ability to access a service through because they're stuck in the home with.
Thank you. Yeah. I do appreciate that. And for all the work that you do, it's amazing.
Thank you.
My last question through you, Chair Henry, is with all the motion and the support that you're getting in from each municipality, where is this, what is the next step for you?
Mm-hmm. Well, our hope is that if it's that an epidemic is declared, the implementation of this recommendation would help create an awareness, obviously, across our region. And our hope is that the province would do it as well, and even nationally, so that this is the intimate partner violence is recognized as an epidemic, as an emergency issue within our communities and societies, and therefore decision makers like yourselves can create policies and legislation that will support the efforts to end this and stop it from happening. When it's not, the hope is that having this as an declared an epidemic will just create that awareness. It also validates the tens of thousands of women who are experiencing this across the province and across our country.
Thank you. Through you, Chair Henry, I commend the tremendous work that your teams do.
Thank you.
Luke's Place, Victim Services, and yourself. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councillor Cook, you were on the list. Did you withdraw your request?
Yes, I did. My question was answered.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Wu? Sorry, one second, please. Go ahead now.
Yeah, through the chair, and thank you very much for coming forward. And I want to reflect back, and one that happened in Bowenville back in 1998. And for this particular person, a beautiful person, Jennifer Copperthorne, she was just at that time 24 years of age and went to work. And her boyfriend at the time was stalking her and killed her.
Yeah.
He was sentenced, but, you know, it's horrific. And the parents, and I do know both the parents, how it devastated them, how it affected the relationship. In fact, to the point they were no longer together. Mm-hmm. And, you know, these things, it does happen. If I go further back, probably it dates back. And then one that is more notable, O.J. Simpson.
Mm-hmm.
That would be categorized in the same, you know, intimate partner violence. Stiffening of restraining orders and putting teeth into it.
Mm-hmm.
Question?
Yeah. Now, for those, and I think if I can, and thank you, Chair Henry, would you say the difficult part in that is for the victims to leave their, or the abused leaving their partners and first of all, finding some place to go?
Absolutely. So the most dangerous time for a woman is when she is attempting to leave or has left or recently left, which is why shelters and agencies like Victim Services, the four shelters are very important because we can help safety plan through that process. When I speak of the Pezhanovsky family, that's exactly what was happening there, is that there was a separation trying to happen. And why these agencies they need proper funding, they need proper support, because the reality is it isn't always safe to go to your sister's house or your friend's house. So these organizations are there to support women and help them identify the red flags that might be creating more risk and help them get connected with all types of resources across the region to help keep them safe. That's ultimately our goal. I mean, we'll never know how many women we've saved by them coming into the shelter, but we know we have. And I'll speak to, I went to elementary school with Jennifer Copperthorne, so it's close to my heart, that case as well.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Councillor Kerr, questions, please?
Yes. Vanessa, when I was a professor at Durham, every year in my Canadian Contemporary Social Issues course, I always included elder, child, and spouse abuse for the reasons of why you're here today. Mm-hmm. And at that time, through my sources at Durham Regional Police and Denise House, I was given statistics of 27 cycles of violence before the woman would report. And I'm just wondering, do you still keep those kinds of statistics? And if so, how many cycles currently as compared to, you know, 10 years ago when I was doing this? What are the stats in that area? Can you comment on that today?
I can't comment on a recent stat on that for you, unfortunately, I'm sorry. But we do keep sort of informally data individually. It's not something that we're reporting to our funders or anything. We ask women, like, have you reported to police? And then we just talk about if they want to do that, why they don't do that. But we know that most people who experience abuse do not report to police. Most do not even access a shelter. Our numbers are high, and those are the very small amount of women and children who are actually accessing a shelter. So this is why we're trying to highlight the epidemic of it. It's happening in many, many homes. And many children are being witness to it or experiencing it, young girls, and why education and having policies that promote our services to get out into the community to really educate what is happening and what supports are there for people who are experiencing it, even if you don't want to come to shelter. There's a lot of supports that are available.
Well, at the time, it was only 1 in 10 women that reported, so it's tip of the iceberg. And thank you for your work. It's nice to see Sandra here today. And Mr. Chair, thank you. I'd be in support of what's being requested here today. Thank you.
Thank you. That exhausts the questions. Okay. But if you just step back for a minute.
Sure.
Councillor Crawford, it would be appropriate now, my suggestion would be, is you ask for to alter the agenda to bring your notice of motion forward. I know that Councillor Dyes would have been here, but I understand that you've had a conversation with Councillor McCaughey,
yes,
who will second this. So, Councillor McCaughey, I'll let you move the motion. I'll look for a seconder. Okay, so move the motion, please. To alter the agenda?
I'd like to move a motion to alter the agenda.
To bring your notice of motion forward at this time.
Exactly.
Okay, thank you. Clerk has captured that. The seconder would be Councillor McCaughey. Okay, I'm going to call the vote now. All those in favor? In opposition? Seeing none. So now your notice of motion is brought forward. Members of Council, the notice of motion is located on page 67 of your agenda. It is moved by Councillor Crawford. It would have been seconded by Councillor Dyes, but she is not here. But Councillor McCaughey has offered to second that for today. So the motion is now on the floor, Mr. Clerk. Councillor Crawford, I think because the delegation is just presented, I think we could start with the not therefore be resolved part. And if you'd like to read 1, 2, 3 into the agenda as the mover, please.
Yes. Not therefore be it resolved that the Durham region declare IPV an epidemic and call the Ontario government to do the same as per recommendation of one in the Renfrew County inquest, and that the Durham region integrate the IPV into the region's community safety and well-being plan as per recommendation 10 of the Renfrew County inquest, and that this motion be distributed amongst all the Durham MPPs, the Ministry of Attorney General, and the Ministry of Women, Social and Economic Opportunity at the lower tier Durham municipalities, Durham Regional Police Service Board, Renfrew County, and the Association of Municipalities of Ontario.
Okay, thank you. Now, would you like to speak to it?
Yes, sir. Thank you. Through you, thank you for this presentation. Thank you for bringing it to Ajax. And I'm looking for support for this motion. I think we've heard enough police reports over the last term and this term that we know that this is one of the most underreported crimes out there right now. In fact, it has been renamed. I just found out when you guys came to Ajax, it used to be referred to as domestic violence and has been changed to literally intimate partner violence, which is the first time I'd heard our new chief mention it in the last report. And I think at that time he said there was a 20% increase in that crime. And knowing that it is underutilized, who knows really how many women are out there, whether they feel embarrassed, whether it's a religious or a cultural thing, or that they actually blame themselves for this violence. So I believe that it's our responsibility to support families and to make it safe for them to report, and that their criminal partners be convicted. And we cannot stand by and let this happen on a daily basis. I can't imagine what this does to children to have to see this every single day, or actually experience every single day in their homes. So I think it's a no-brainer, but I am asking for your support.
Okay, thank you. Councillor McCaughey, as the seconder of the motion, would you like to speak to it?
Yes, just briefly. I really want to thank Marilyn for bringing this forward. I really appreciate it. It's so important, and your presentation both today and the other night. I know you helped form our motion in WIPI the other night, and it's such an important topic. And I think that there's not one of us that doesn't know somebody that has suffered abuse, and it's high time we call it the epidemic that it is. So thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Shahid.
Through you, Chair Henry, just asking for a recorded vote. It is
recorded
very important.
Appropriate
thank
time.
You.
Absolutely. Councillor Chapman.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have an amendment I'd like to add to it that it also goes to FCM. Mayor Carter would like to second that. This is
just before you speak to it, could we also say, if you're open to another suggestion, that it goes to all our federal partners in the same ministries?
Sure.
At the same time.
Terrific idea. What my point is there is that, and as we heard, and as we all know, or at least we all should know, this is not an epidemic to Durham region, to Ontario. This is even broader than Canada, let's be honest. It's North America, at least worldwide. So I think it's important that we also let the folks from FCM and our federal counterparts, their federal counterparts, as you said, know this declaration and that these recommendations that have come through Renfrew County on this matter, that they're important and that we see them as important, and we hope that at least the rest of the country will too.
So just so on our federal counterparts, we're talking about MPs.
Yes.
We're talking about the federal Solicitor General, Minister of Public Safety.
Yeah, we've listed here all Durham MPPs, so it would include Durham MPs. The Ministry of Attorney General should be the federal Minister of, yes. Justice, right? Ministry of Women, Social, Economic Opportunity, the federal level of who does that work at the federal, I would also suggest, although they probably already know it, that it goes to the Ontario Provincial Police, because yes, we're going to send it to our police board because we work with them. But I think Solicitor General, who is the Ontario Solicitor General, should be included because that's the upper level of the Ontario Provincial Police that I know are dealing with similar things throughout the province.
Mayor Carter is the seconder on the amendment. You're good with that. To our clerk, you've captured the essence. Perfect.
Okay.
We'll do it as an amendment. Okay. So, members of council, this is put on the floor as an amendment to the motion. I don't think we need a recorded vote on the amendment, but I'm going to call the vote. All those in favor? Okay. The amendment carries. The main motion as amended, there is a recorded vote called. And Mr. Clerk, when you're ready, could you please call that vote?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Recorded vote on the main motion as amended is beginning now.
Unanimous by all members present. Okay, so that carries. That is passed. It's unanimous amongst all members present, both in the chambers and online. So that carries. Sorry. So that carries. So thank you for being here today. You're welcome to stay if you choose, but I will give you a couple minutes to exit the chamber if you would like to leave now.
Thank you.
So thank you. Members of Council, we'll now continue with our agenda. So we'll now go to item 7.1. It's a expropriation of lands for a proposed bus rapid transit loop. Could I have somebody move the recommendation, please? Moved by Councillor Lee, seconded by Councillor Anderson. So the recommendation is to adopt A, B, C, D, E contained in CC10. Members of Council, it's on the floor. Seeing no one, oh, thank you, Mr. Clerk. We'll call the vote. All those in favor? In opposition? Seeing none, that carries. Members of Council, we'll now go to reports. First report is on page 69 of your agenda. Sorry. Mr. Clerk, can I have the sheets, please? Thank you. Sorry. Just one second, please. So, members of Council, we will start by with finance, that the recommendations contained in item 1-4, inclusive report number 4 of the financing administrator, be adopted. Moved by Mayor Ash, seconded by Councillor Leahy. Polls. Okay, we'll go to Councillor Nicholson. You have a pull?
Yes, I'd like to pull item 1 and ask for a recorded vote.
Right, okay, for a vote. Mayor Foster, you have a pull?
Yes, please. Quick question on 3.
On 3. Any others? So, Mr. Clerk, I'm going to call the vote on 2 and 4. All those in favor? In opposition? Seeing none, that carries. Councillor Nicholson, you've pulled item 1. Did you want to speak to it?
I think the motion is self-evident. I'm just asking for a recorded vote at this time.
Okay. Councillor Crawford on item 1.
Yes, I just wanted to mention that at the Ontario Big Cities Mayor's AGM, we passed a motion to support this also.
Okay, thank you. Seeing no other hands, and Mr. Clerk online. We have no one, so a recorded vote was called. Could you call the vote now, please?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Recorded vote on item one of the FNA report is starting now.
Carried unanimously. That is carried unanimously. Item number three, Mayor Foster, on this one here, is it a question of an open session nature? Okay, Mayor Foster, go ahead, please. Can you push your request to speak? It dropped. Thank you.
Alrighty, thank you, Mr. Chair. Through you to the Commissioner, and Ms. Taylor and I had a chat. This is a common theme. The question would be, do we have any means of ascertaining and reporting if we are making progress? So we've known for a number of years that we've got a real issue with recruitment amongst, I'm going to call it senior staff. Trend lines, are they going up, going down? Are we doing everything that we need to do? And again, and I know you've heard this many times, my apologies for chewing on the same bone, but as reporting comes out, instead of a snapshot in time, is there a way of letting us know if we're doing all, if you need more support from council, I guess a view of how we're doing longer term?
So if I may, through the chair, and then certainly the commissioner can add to this, you and I did speak very briefly yesterday on this issue, and really it's about tracking our performance on number of retirements, number of succession plans, the people that have been promoted. So I'll put the question to our commissioner, but I think we can certainly do some work on statistics to give you some general information.
Through you, Mr. Chair, yes, we can pull some information for you. Maybe you and I could speak after and determine what type of statistics you'd like to hear about. It's almost a moving target as we have so many recruitments each year. But if there's anything specific that we could provide, I'd be willing to do that.
Thank you, Ms. Good. We'll chat, and not for this report, but moving forward.
Okay.
And yeah, I have no idea what numbers are going to be meaningful.
Thank you.
So thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Thank you. There was another request to speak, and it dropped before Mayor Collier. Was that you? No? Okay. All right, then we'll go to Mayor Collier.
And it's up to Pickering to do the safeguards.
Hello?
Because that piece is in there.
You're online. Mayor Collier? Hello?
No, Chair, I didn't ask to speak.
Okay, thank you. Is there anyone else wishing to speak to this item? Seeing none. He's back up on my screen again. Okay, we'll call the vote. All those in favor? In opposition? Seeing none, that carries. The next, we're going to move to the recommendations contained in items 1 and 2, inclusive report number 3 of Health and Social Services. Mayor Roy is not in the chamber, so I'm going to ask that Councillor Anderson, as a member of this committee, will you move this report? Okay. Mayor Foster, as a seconder, because you're a member of this committee, would you move that report? Okay. The report is now on the floor. Wait a second. Oh, yes, sorry. I have a note here, too. I apologize. On the Health and Social Services agenda, it's contained on page 59 and page 59. You have to excuse me. I have to have a conversation with the clerk. Just one second. Members of council, I just one second with the clerk. Who else in the social services? So members of council, on one of the items that are located on the health and social services agenda, you have to, and I'm just going to read this to you. Council members, on item one of the Health and Social Services Committee report relates to operations of the regional long-term care homes and is being considered and approved by the Committee of Management. This is new. If you have submitted the documentation to the Clerk's Department to participate on the Committee of Management, please feel free to engage in debate and vote on this item. If you have not submitted the requirement documentation, please refrain from participating. Now, Councillor Anderson, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to withdraw your as the mover, and I'm going to go to Councillor Jubb. Councillor Jubb, will you move that? Okay. So now the items are on the floor. So the health and social services items are one and two. Is there a member of council wishing to pull either of these two items? Mayor Carter, question? You're going to pull two? Perfect. We need to vote on one separately. So, members of council, so Mr. Clerk, I'm going to call the vote.
Just ask for show of hands of those who have submitted on number one.
Okay. Members of council, when you vote, you have to have submitted your documentation. So I'm going to trust that when I call for a show of hands that you have done that. Okay, a recorded vote is in order. If you haven't submitted your documentation, you're not allowed to vote. Sorry. Not unless it's in the possession of the clerk prior to this meeting. Like, if you've done it now, then that's fine. Okay, I'm sorry, members of council, this is getting complicated. Mayor Foster, if you have a question, request to speak.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So, you know, I'll admit if my EA put it in front of me, I've submitted it. But I honestly, well, and frankly, as much as everyone's laughing, I mean, a huge, so I have no idea, quite frankly, keeping track.
So what we'll do is the clerk is going on this, is going to gather a recorded vote. Mr. Clerk, on after the recorded vote, will you reach out to each member of council, send the documentation again so that we can make it happen? Is there any other, does that answer your question?
So I'm sorry, are we expecting documentation to come to
you're gonna,
before
what,
a vote now?
So,
do you mind if I?
So I'm going to, there's no need for a 5-minute recess. But thank you for the offer. Mr. Clerk, do you want to explain what we're trying to do here, please?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So last week, reminders were distributed to council members based on the documentation that we've received from each of you individually to date. Several members have submitted all of their completed documentation. Just for reference, one portion is the required police record check, and the other portion is the offense declaration form. We do have a little over half of council members present today have submitted all of their paperwork. If you have not submitted it for a recorded vote, we would ask that you press the conflict button on your panel. This will exclude you from the vote. We are happy to confirm with any individual members after this meeting, either by email or in person, if we are missing any documentation from you and can assist you in preparing that.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. So we'll deal with item one first. Recorded vote has been called. Councillor Shahid, question?
I think my question is answered. No police check, no vote. That's it.
Thank you for that. Okay. So everyone understands the vote. It's been properly moved and properly seconded. We'll call the vote now. All those in favor? To record a vote. Ms. Quirk, mine's not lit. Okay, sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The recorded vote will begin momentarily. A reminder, if you have not submitted the required documentation, please press the conflict button on your panel. The recorded vote is beginning now.
So members of council, that carries. Mayor Carter, on item number two.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and good morning. In regards to this item here, it's about the staff being directed to report back on the engagement plan at the next Health and Social Services. I guess the question being is, what is the expectation out of this action? I'm just curious. I know that we want to try and engage, and we want to try and make sure that everybody is fully engaged and that they have a plan or a commitment, but are we, you know, how fast, when, and what is the expectation of the engagement, I guess?
So I can speak to that.
Yeah, please.
So it's in committee, it's about getting the information we need to support our ask, and it will come to council, to have this declared a national crisis.
Okay.
And I'll go to, we'll go to Ms. Taylor, who is our acting CAO today.
So through the chair, a report is being drafted to go on the CIP this Friday to give you the preliminary information of steps that we'll be coming forward with. And then a second report will be coming to Health and Social Services Committee in June in order to promote advocacy with the federal government. So you will see a CIP report this Friday just to lay out, presumably answer the questions that you have. And Allison Burgess is also here, who's been working on that, so if there's any specific questions. But there is a CIP report coming this week to lay out those steps.
Just out of curiosity, who's going to be leading that lobbying or advocacy work?
So through the chair, the CAO is away this week, as you're aware. As soon as she gets back, we'll have discussions with her on how it's going to be championed. Allison Burgess may be able to speak to it in particular.
Thank you very much, and through the chair. So our current GR consultant is Strategy Corps, and you know, we are going out with an RFP to bring on a new GR consultant, and so we'll know more at that time. They'll be supporting our lobbying efforts, and this will add on, I think, Mayor Carter, to the collaborative work that we're looking to do together to ensure that the local area municipalities in the region are aligned with our advocacy efforts going forward.
I appreciate that. I just don't want us to get in the way, but we also have an obligation at the local municipalities to do everything we possibly can to advocate on behalf of the situations that we're facing, especially in Ajax, Oshawa, and Whitby. And I know that all of us are trying to use our connections, but we also want to make sure it's a coordinated effort. So I just want to make sure that that all the municipalities are part of that direction. So.
Okay.
I'm fine with it. Thank you very much. I would just appreciate it. And thank you, Ms. Taylor, for the timing. I think I'm glad to see that it's being expedited quite quickly and that we'll have that report before the break. So I think that's great news. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Members of Council, is there Councillor Nicholson on the item?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a question. Will this report also be looking at the shortfall in supports from Durham Region to the lower tier municipalities, given that many of the lower tier municipalities on the homelessness issue are spending millions of dollars of their lower tier tax revenues to offset, which is inherently a social services and housing issue, and the region is not fulfilling its full mandate replacing that money? Will this report deal with that as well?
Well, Councillor Nicholson, before I go to staff, I can tell you that the region in our last budget, I believe we have $22 million invested in homelessness, opiate-related challenges, mental health, and that we are working with our lower-tier members to support issues. But I'll have our acting CAO respond, and then whoever you need to support your...
Certainly. So through the chair, there are a sequence of reports coming to Health and Social Services Committee, particular to the region's actions and plans on the homelessness file. So you will see several reports. One is more of an education report, I'll paraphrase it as that, to outline everything that the region is doing currently. And then the subsequent one after that is to look at concrete plans for this year. So if I may, I'll also see whether our Commissioner of Social Services has anything to comment. But there are definite reports coming before council recess on that issue.
Through the chair, that's correct. Councillor Nicholson, we have a series of reports coming. And along with that, we also have some reports and presentations from Dr. Kell, the Medical Officer of Health's office.
Well, I appreciate that. The specific question, is there going to be in the report a section that's going to deal with the Region of Durham reimbursing lower tier municipalities for expenses that are falling within the mandate of social services and housing? The state of Oshawa is expending over $3 million a year from the lower tier tax is collected, and this is more rightly a regional responsibility. So will there be a report on how the region is going to reimburse the lower tiers for their costs incurred?
So through the chair, if I may, a report is forthcoming with respect to the City of Oshawa's request on security questions. Beyond that, the regional budget as approved by this regional council has provided the direction on the spending and funding on homelessness assistance and services. So this regional council has approved through the budget what their actions will be, but there is a report forthcoming with respect to the City of Oshawa specific request.
Okay. As a follow-up, will that report address not only what the expenditures are approved to date in the budget, but whether the other funds may be made available from various avenues to reimburse the lower tier for those costs?
So as part of this, last Friday, I had the privilege of attending an announcement with Mayor Carter where the province is finally hearing us. They've been listening, but they have not been hearing us. So we received $18.6 million on Friday afternoon to support, correct, Mayor Carter, 18.6?
My understanding is I think that that's what the announcement was, but I think it was an additional $6 million. Or $7 million that was announced. And the good news about that was my understanding is from Minister of Finance that that will be ongoing funding. It's not a one-time funding, so that's specific.
So we are now being heard by the province and receiving additional funds to support the challenges we're having in all eight municipalities.
Well, I do appreciate that the province may be finally hearing us as an Oshawa Regional Councillor and an Oshawa Local Councillor combined. I'm hopeful that the region is here in Oshawa, finally, and understanding the great financial impact on our taxpayers from this growing epidemic as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak on this item? Mayor Carter, you pulled it. Just a regular vote's fine.
No, let's do a record vote.
Okay. Mayor Carter, Chris requested a recorded vote. Mr. Clerk, when you're ready. Councillor Nicholson, you might want to turn your mic off. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Recorded vote on item number 2 of the Health and Social Services Report is beginning now.
Okay, members of council, that carries. Members of council, will turn on to page 60 of the agenda. Moved by Councillor Chapman, seconded by Councillor Pickles, that the recommendations contained in items 1, 2, 4, inclusive report number 4 of the Planning and Economic Development Committee be adopted. Polls. Online. One poll. Mayor Schumer, which item? Just hold your fingers up for me.
Item 1.
Which item?
1.
Item number 1.
1.
Thank you. So, okay. Are there any other polls? Seeing none, I will call the vote on the remainder, which would be 2, 3, and 4. All those in favor? In opposition? Seeing none, that carries. Mayor Schumer, if you could push your request to speak button on item number 1. Go ahead, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I'm happy that the committee endorsed the request and the draft letter. My question, I guess, is what additional clarification was requested?
Oh, sorry, Mr. Bridgman.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, through you to Mayor Schumer. The additional item of clarification was just to check in with MPP Scott to make sure that she was in agreement with the letter before it goes to the Minister of Transportation, and that meeting is coming up, and the meeting will, rather the letter, will be sent immediately following that meeting, which has been scheduled, and we understand in preliminary terms that everyone is supportive of the letter.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. On the item, any other members wishing to speak to it? Seeing none, we'll call the vote. All those in favor? In opposition? Seeing none, that carries. We'll move on to works located on page 62 of your agenda. Moved by Mayor Barton, seconded by Councillor Mayor Pietri, that the recommendations contained in items 1 and 2 inclusive report for the Works Committee be adopted. Polls? Online? Seeing none, I'll call the vote on the two items. All those in favor? In opposition? Seeing none, that carries. Members of Council, we'll move to the committee whole report on page 64. The recommendations contained in items 1 to 5, inclusive of report number 4, that can be adopted. Members of Council, I need a mover. Moved by Councillor Mayor Pietri, seconded by Councillor Wu. Polls. Ms. Quirk online. Seeing none, I will call for the vote on the committee of the whole. All those in favor? In opposition? Seeing none, that carries. Did you get the mover and the seconder, Madam Clerk? Okay, so just 1 second, members of council. I will. Thank you. Okay. We have dealt with the notice of motion already. Members of council, there is no unfinished business. Mr. Clerk, the business of the day has been covered. Just a reminder that we will have an event out in the lobby. Mr. Clerk, is lunch being brought in?
Yes.
Lunch will be brought in, and I will go to Mayor Ash for the bylaws. Oh, sorry. I'm sorry. Announcements.
Thank you. I do have an announcement tonight. Colleagues, the Pickering Casino Resort is officially opening. I know a number of you are joining. A number have asked about the timing of the event tonight. There is a reception from 5 till 6, and the official opening is at 6 p.m. There's a dinner after for those staying, and those lucky enough, the concert starts at 8 o'clock with Brian Adams, who have tickets. So thank you for that. And while I have the microphone, I note that Mayor Foster has not made an announcement about the Butter Tart Festival in Bowmanville this weekend, because I understand he may be keeping them to himself. So that's my announcement.
Ash, throwing me under the bus like that. It's true, I'm judging, I'm keeping them all, but yes, there is a Butter Tart Festival. But further to that, Mayor Ash, I thought Pickering had secured tickets to the concert for all members of council and the leadership team here. I'm shocked.
They're in the mail. I have to apologize. The first thing when you missed this is came to my mind is your tardiness on this issue, Mayor Foss. So.
We share the same sense of humor.
Sorry.
Call it sour grapes.
Councillor Wu.
Well, as a follow-up to that, Chair Henry, you're right. The Bumble Butter Tart Festival is happening this Saturday from 10 to 4. And His Sweetness will be one of the judges. Butter tarts, cookies, cannolis, and other tasty treats will be available. And that'll be a great start off to the season, you know, ahead of the, I guess, there's going to be ribs and brews happening across the region, but Clareton is fortunate to have the first Butter Tart Festival with, like I say, His Sweetness, Your Worship, Mayor Foster being one of the judges. And now the other one that I do have, and it just follows up to our delegation this morning about the intimate partner violence and certainly the support. Our shelter in Bowmanville, supporting Durham Region, certainly supporting Clareton. Bethesda House is having their 18th annual dinner and auction on Thursday, May 4th, and that will be held at the Newcastle Community Hall. So two great events to support in Clareton. Thank you.
Councillor Wu, because Clareton is such a large community, where is the Butter Tart Festival taking place? I'll get your microphone turned on. Roger, please. Thank you.
Yeah, the Bumble Butter Tart Festival will be held at the Bumble Butter Tart Park. No, tart. No. The Garnet B. Rickard Community Complex.
Complex, okay. So it's indoors, right? Okay.
I don't think it'll be indoors, but I mean, yes, they're calling for a steady amount of rain, so I don't know what the backup plan for the organizers are.
Mayor?
Is it? Oh, sorry. Indoors. See, I'm being corrected. I think Mayor Foster is correct.
Lots of debate on butter tarts. It's indoors, right?
In the past, it has been. I have no indication that it's not.
Thank you.
But there will be an exceptionally long line.
Okay, thank you. Mayor Roy.
There we go. And I apologize for this morning. My dentist called. I'm proud to announce that we have the Mixability Rugby Invitational Club, located out of the Vikings Rugby organization. We have four players who will be going off to Belfast on May 20th, 2023. It's a great honor to be a part of this, and Deputy Mayor Crawford is a part of this event. It's a little bit of a competition, but it's Celebrity Bartending Night at Royal Oaks in Whitby Shores on May 3rd from 5 to 7. There will be celebrity bartenders, including myself and Marilyn Crawford, and we will be helping to raise funds because it's going to require about $16,000 to send this team. It's pretty phenomenal. They only started a year ago, and it's great to see that those with inabilities and abilities coming together, and they'll be competing in Ireland, and looking forward to giving them our support, and hopefully you can come out. We take tips. And you can actually donate online to them as well, too. But I think it'll be a great evening, too, with the competition that's going to go on between the bartenders that night. So thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Lee.
Thank you, Chair. For obvious reasons, I want to note that on May 1st, it is Asian Heritage Month. So just a shout out to all my Asian peeps out there. And I think, it's a great day to celebrate Asian heritage and our contributions to Canadian the Canadian fabric. Thank you, Chair.
Well, thank you. And on that note, Asian Heritage Month was first recognized in Canada in May of 2002. And a Senate motion introduced by the Honorable Dr. Toy the first Canadian Asian of Asian descent to be appointed to the Senate of Canada. So it is a great announcement.
I'm going to be number two, guys.
Noted. Next, we'll go to Mayor Collier. Mayor Collier? Okay, we'll move on to Councillor Chapman. Oh, sorry. Mayor Collier?
My mic's on.
I must have done by accident. My apologies. I didn't want to speak.
You didn't want to speak. Okay. Thank you. Councillor Chapman.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to let everybody know about the annual dinner and cake auction for the in support of the refuge youth shelter in Oshawa. It's going to be held at Heritage Hall, Purple Woods, on May the 27th. It's a three-course dinner at 6 o'clock, catered by New Leaf Catering. And then there's a cake auction, and the auctioneer is my good friend Barney here. And it's on May 27, 2023. You can get tickets online or make donations. Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Lee, your name has come back up again on the screen, but you've already spoken. Did you? Okay. So thank you. We'll go to Mayor Barton.
Hey, thank you very much, everyone. I just wanted to say thank you. We got a number of letters of support for provincially owned lands in Uxbridge that has now been proposed as a provincial park. Thanks to everyone who helped out. Thanks to Chair Henry for all of his hard work and staff. So great news for Uxbridge.
It was a great event. Members of council received information on that, but the largest, I believe, a portion of lands are Durham Forests, just under 600 hectares, correct?
Well, I think TRCA lands could be higher too, but anyway, we're all putting these, we're going to be meeting and talking about it soon.
We're all working together.
Yeah.
Great announcement. Is there any other announcements? Online? Seeing none, so we'll go to you, Mayor Ash, on bylaws, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. It's moved by myself, second by Councillor Brenner, that bylaws number 26-2023 to 35-2023 inclusive be passed, and that bylaw be dated 26th day of April, 2023.
Okay, thank you. So on the bylaws, we'll call the vote. All those in favor? In opposition? Seeing none, that carries. Please continue.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. It's moved by myself, again, second by Councillor Brenner, that bylaw number 36-2023, being a bylaw to confirm the proceedings of the Council of the Regional Municipality of Durham at their meeting held on the 26th day of April, 2023, be passed, and the date of this bylaw be the 26th day of April, 2023.
Members of Council on the confirming bylaw, all those in favor? In opposition? That carries. Last business of the day is adjournment, Mr. Clerk. Looking for a motion to adjourn, moved by Councillor Nicholson, seconded by Councillor Leahy. On adjournment, I will call the vote. All those in favor? In opposition? Seeing none, that carries. Again, members of Council, before you leave and staff, there is an announcement at 12 o'clock. Outside the council chambers, I would ask that if you can stay, please stay. And lunch will be in the back room. Thank you and have a safe day. To the staff, thank you for all that you've done to get on today's meeting. Thank you.